I am Brad Keelor. He is Ryan Maugh. Next up on Director's Cut, find out how ASCE changed his life. Everybody, and welcome to Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every 7 days, until I get fired or until somebody tells me to stop, I sit down with a different GI member. They will tell us stories about their life. Some of them are personal, some of them are professional, and all of them are fun. If you are not familiar with the Geo Institute, this is as good a time as any. Head on over to geoinstitute.org after you watch this interview and check us out. We're a member society, a technical society, housed within the American Society of Civil Engineers. We have about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers or geologists. If you like what you're about to see, and I think you will, click subscribe, click get notifications, and we will let you know every single time we post something to the YouTube channel, like Director's Cut. I am really excited this week to be joined from Salt Lake City, Utah, by Ryan Maugh, who is a principal there at Gerhart Coal. Ryan, welcome.
Thanks, Brad. Great to be here.
We are going to have some fun today. We have 10 questions, as always. There are two that we ask every single guest when they come on Director's Cut. And the first one is as follows. Describe your job in 45 seconds.
Brad, I am a technical consultant that solves complicated, challenging, and fun problems. I get to address societal challenges and make the world a better place through building resilient communities and making sure that as a steward of society, that the world can continue on when it faces challenges.
That was so succinct. And I did notice that you put the word fun in there. And this has to be your first bonus question here. What do you consider the most fun project that you've ever been able to work on?
So one of my favorite projects is the US 89 reconstruction project in northern Utah. What made that such a special project and fun was it was one of the first progressive design builds ever done by the Utah Department of Transportation. And they've really embraced alternative delivery, and it put us in an environment where we were working very collaboratively with the contractor, the owner, and an exceptional design team. And there were some real challenges, including constructing bridges adjacent, and in some cases, over faults, navigating challenges with utilities and other things in an urban corridor. And it was a great team that came together and did great things. I think beyond what I do for my job, we do cool stuff, right? We're engineers, we solve problems. But I think the most important question is how do I do it, right? How do I do my job? And the most important thing is that I'm a part of a great team. And that team includes my organization firm, Gerhart Coal. I work with extraordinary people that have superpowers. And I also work with a collection of clients, their DOTs, their water districts, or other entities that are equally committed to doing great things. And because of those relationships, we're able to solve very challenging problems. Philosophically, I really believe that great teams do great things, and I am grateful to be part of great teams.
So another follow-up question here. Do you mention that project every time you drive on that road? And does your family get tired of it?
Absolutely. In fact, my 4-year-old daughter, at the time she was 4, she knows what a lattice crane is. So I'm pretty proud. Hashtag parent of the year, right?
So. That is fantastic. So we have to ask a bunch of fun questions on Director's Cut too. And I hope this one made you think about it, because I know I would have to ask somebody else about this question. What phrase do you say the most, and when did you start saying it?
So I grew up in the prime time era of Will Ferrell, and I love Will Ferrell quotes, right? If you're not first, you're last. I can go on and on and on. But I want to share with you the perfect setup to a Will Ferrell quote. So I was working on a mining project in Arizona. It was the middle of the summer, probably June-ish, July. And we're out there working with drilling crews. And anyone who's worked in geotechnical engineering knows that you develop a pretty close relationship with the drillers, your friends and coworkers, right, when you're drilling for weeks at a time. And we're drilling at temperatures at 120, degrees during the summer, and they swapped the crew out and they brought a guy in from Canada. So we're doing our tailgate safety meeting first thing in the morning, and he shows up. He's got 2 liters of chocolate milk, and he's about halfway through the first one. It's 6 a.m., right? So I said to him at our tailgate safety meeting, I was like, hey, man, have you been in hot weather before? And he's like, no, man, I'm Canadian. The hottest I get's like whatever it is in centigrade. And then I'm like, what's that in Fahrenheit? He's like, oh, like 80 degrees. I'm like, you might just want to take it easy on that milk. So I'm watching him 6 a.m., right? I'm watching the day heating up, and I'm drilling and doing other things. And I'm just watching him start to turn shades of green. And starting at about 11:30, I look over, and he just fails to the front of the drill rig, and he's up there retching. So as he's running to the front of the drill rig, perfect Will Ferrell quote, I said to him and the rest of the crew, milk was a bad choice. And by the way, Anchorman, which is the genesis of that, is a Christmas music, a movie. We watch that every year with my brother. So anyway, that's the perfect setup.
I always find it weird on Director's Cut how things come up in a couple weeks in succession. We talked about milk with Menzer in last week's episode, and then here we are again. And I think you're right. And this is actually a Ben Stiller one, but it's from a Will Ferrell movie, from Zoolander. And so I'm on the roof of the Canadian Embassy in Washington, D.C., with the heads of all these space agencies from around the world, and the DC reps for all the space agencies. So they're taking a photo of all of us with the Capitol in the background, and we're standing there, and the photographer says, can everybody turn to the right? And I just deadpan, I'm not an ambi-turner. And like 2 people in the group laugh hysterically, and everybody else just stares at me like I'm the biggest freak on the face of the earth. But there's a quote from a Will Ferrell movie Perfect. For pretty much every occasion. So that was fantastic. I love that story. We have to ask you a little bit about the work that you work on now or research from grad school, and we'll tie them together. So what topic or research from grad school do you not work at all on professionally, and does it make you sad? Do you miss it at all?
So there was a real focus on earthquake engineering and deep foundations and other important topics at Utah State University, where I attended, Go Aggies. And we had a section on tsunamis. And we had to do a lab and do a bunch of different write-ups, look at a few different things. And so I spent a fair amount of time in that earthquake engineering environment looking at tsunamis. And fortunately, I have never had to deal with a tsunami in my career. We do have seiches, but they're very small compared to tsunamis. And so gratefully, I don't have to deal with tsunamis, even though it's kind of an interesting topic.
That is a great answer. Very succinct, too. That tsunamis are fascinating. I mean, following the one this week from the Tonga eruption has been super interesting, I think. So another question I have to ask you. The first time I came to Salt Lake City, I'm looking at the road signs and I see these gigantic numbers, you know, 8,500, 10,600, whatever. And I'm like, that's the entire name of the road? Like, how do they do this? Like, I'm sure it relates to something. Can you explain for all of us outsiders the numbering system of the road system in the Salt Lake City area?
Absolutely. I'll tell you why Utah's awesome. You got it, Brad. So when the pioneers came to Utah and settled in the Salt Lake Valley, as well as other communities across the Wasatch Front, they basically had a clean slate. There wasn't other roads here. There wasn't necessarily a whole lot of people. And so when they laid the city out, being pioneers, they basically had a focal point in the city in Salt Lake, which was the temple or the synagogue where they went to worship, an important part of the LDS faith. And so that area, Temple Square, became the center of the community. And so they basically set up a system, a Cartesian system, in which north, south, east, and west, you increase with every block or distance away from that Temple Square. And so as you move to the north, say you wanted to go to 500 east and 200 north, you would go 2 blocks north of the temple and then 5 blocks east, and there you'd be. And that's kind of the way that a lot of the cities were set up throughout Utah. Not everyone's got a temple at the center, but Salt Lake, at least, it's that way. So people come here and they see these big numbers like 10,600 or 12,300 or 146,000. south. And if you just kind of think of it in terms of like kips, right, we kind of round it. So 10,600 becomes 106. So if you want to find a direction here, if you didn't have Google, it's easy. I go to 106 south, and then east or west, I go either towards the mountains or away from the mountains, and that's where the location's at. And it's a pretty slick system, but having lived in Seattle and a few other cities, I understand why it's unique and different, but it's very, once you've got it and it clicks, everything makes sense.
Very cool. And you don't have any of those big boulevards or avenues cutting across. Like DC is kind of a nightmare in that way, because you'd be traveling along and all of a sudden you have an intersection with seven streets coming all in one place. I like driving in Salt Lake. I can handle that.
Yeah, we have a great DOT here, one of the best in the country, and we've got a great system in place.
So when we talked about the questions in advance, we talked about candy a little bit, and you brought one up that I had never even heard of in my life. Come to find out, you can get these almost anywhere, but I had never had them. You have to tell the people what you love about cinnamon bears. Well, first you have to tell them what cinnamon bears are and then why you love them.
So for the uninformed, at least yet, because if you take one thing out of this discussion we have here today, you need to try cinnamon bears. So a cinnamon bear is essentially a gummy bear in terms of consistency, and it's got a cinnamon flavor to it. My kids refer to them as spicy bears. So you bite into them, and they've kind of got this gummy consistency, and then they've got some spice or kick to them. And for me, the cinnamon bears are great. The next level is chocolate-covered cinnamon bears. So they actually, cinnamon bears dipped in chocolate. You bite into them, you get the chocolate and the cinnamon mixed together, and it is amazing. And so I grew up with cinnamon bears. I think a lot of people across the country haven't had it. If you haven't, you should try it.
So engineering question here, but not geotech. How does the chocolate, I guess M&Ms do it, right? But it doesn't melt at all, and it adheres well to the gummy?
It adheres very well to the gummy, and yes, it melts. So pro field tip. Put your chocolate covered cinnamon bears in the freezer before you go out and work and drill. Put them in your cooler. They come out nice and cold. Added benefit, that bite to the cinnamon's a little bit more when it's cold. So yes, they will melt, but there's a simple solution.
That is amazing. We need to have a whole show just about these. We could have a competition where people have to cook with cinnamon bears. I think that would be amazing. I like that.
And just as an added, so I grew up in a home where we actually dipped chocolates. So I have actually dipped and made my own chocolate-covered cinnamon bear. So I am a bit of a connoisseur.
And you can't throw that tidbit in. What's the craziest thing that you dipped in chocolate? You know, either from a positive or a negative standpoint, the best thing and the worst thing.
Twinkies. Twinkies are awesome. The other thing that I really like is, I'm trying to think of, the hardest thing to dip is cherries. So you get like a maraschino cherry, a cordial cherry. And if you think about that as one of the hardest things to do, but I love a really good chocolate dip Twinkie.
Wow. And now I'm going to have to give that a shot. We are not dippers. Maybe I need to become one. So the other question that we ask everybody that comes on the show, and we teased this a little bit at the top, because I think you've got a great answer here. How did you first get involved in ASCE and GI?
So as you kind of alluded to, my life has been changed by ASCE and the Geo Institute. And I'm going to give you two stories to exemplify this. So the first was, I was a sophomore in college at Utah State. I mentioned that. And Blaine Leonard, who many know, who's been very influential in the ASCE sphere, was a sophomore, and he worked with my dad. My dad's a landscape architect at one point in his career. And Blaine was in town for a conference. And so he agreed to meet with me for a little bit and talk to me about civil engineering and what that looks like. And Utah State being an agricultural college, we agreed to meet at the creamery where we got ice cream. And we both put in our orders unbeknownst to us. And I got lemon custard and he got lemon custard. And so I knew we were in for a good time, right? And so we sat down and Blaine took the time to meet with me and help me understand what a career in civil engineering looked like. And there were two things that I took from that conversation. I still remember, it's been almost 20 years. The first thing he said was, if you want to have a career in geotechnical engineering, you need to pursue a graduate education. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing he said to me was, ASCE is an important organization to be involved with. They do great things, and you should get involved. And from there, it was easy, right? I mean, I took on trust, and this is so much of what we do, encouraging people to join organizations is trust. But Blaine said, hey, I've been doing this for a long time. It's worth it. And I became invested in the collegiate chapter, and then I've been active ever since. And so that was kind of the start of my relationship with ASCE, and Blaine's influence was monumental in my career. The second is the Geo-Institute. So I started my career right as the Great Recession was happening. And I went to Seattle. I worked with a great group of engineers. I wanted to go and work for that group up there, geoengineers out of Redmond, because they promised me field work. And I thought that was important. But the other thing they really focused on was they wanted me to be involved in the community activities. And so I went to several chapters. And the Seattle chapter is really fantastic. I had all these positive experiences. And then I moved back to Utah as part of some changes I had going on. And I come to Utah, and we didn't have a chapter. Well, there was a geotechnical group, and that was run by Ryan Cole, who's the Cole and Gerhart Cole. And Ryan had done it for several years. And I reached out to Ryan, and I said, hey, I'm interested in being involved. I had a positive experience in Seattle. And his response was, hey, look, a lot of people express interest, but I really want to see you're committed and interested. So I just kept following up with him. And we got to become pretty good friends as we were going through that. And I suggested we started a chapter, and we started a chapter. And then the ASC report card for Utah happened. This is 2014 or so. And I thought to myself, I'm interacting with Ryan. We're writing some sections of the report card we agreed to do. And I'm thinking, man, who is this guy sending me emails at 6 a.m.? Comments, right? They're very thoughtful. And we would go to lunch and talk about interesting things. And we would set up events that went well. And all this cool stuff just started happening. And not to mention, I got to associate with a tremendous engineer. And so that was very positive. But here's where the story gets really interesting. So all this cool stuff happens. Gerhart Cole was a firm here locally. There was about six people in the firm. And there's an opportunity that opened up for me to join Gerhart Cole. And Ryan said, hey, what do you think about this? And I said, well, I got to think about it and talk to my wife. So I go home to my wife. And she is pregnant with twins, and our first kids. And she's along with the twins. And I say to her, hey, I know I've got a good thing going, and I enjoy the people I work with. I just feel like I really need to explore this. And at the time, I was working at a firm of 90,000 people. So I'm about to go from 90,000 to six, a couple orders of magnitude, right? And my wife's comment, she's not one for cussing, so I'll give you the edited version. She said to me, and you better know what the heck you're doing. She didn't say, right? And so because I had that experience with Ryan, and I was really convinced that we could continue to do cool stuff, I told her, I've got to explore it. We just got to try it. And I left and joined Gerhart Cole. And that experience, and that experience has been tremendous for me. It's changed my life. Ryan has been committed to me as a mentor, as a colleague, and has gone above and beyond in providing feedback. The same things I saw interacting with the Geo-Institute is what I've done for the last 8 or so years. My kids are 7 and a half. And so I think that really changed my life, has provided me with opportunities that I never would have had, and really accelerated my career. So I guess when I think about it, it has changed my life, because these major decisions were heavily influenced by ASCE and by the opportunities it's provided me.
A great answer. And I feel like I say this after this question a lot on these shows, and we've got opportunities for everyone in ASCE. Ryan just gave you the testimonial. He was also involved with our local involvement committee for several years, which is the group that kind of oversees our almost 60 chapters now that we have within GI. You can go to geoinstitute.org, check it out. We have loads of volunteer opportunities up there. If you're not sure how to get involved, you can get involved locally. You can do it nationally. There are things as small as reviewing conference papers. There are things as big as being committee chairs. There's something pretty much for everybody, I think. And if you have any questions, reach out and we'll help you along the way. It really can make a difference in your career. So now we have to flip to a more negative question. After you saying all these great things that have happened to you in your career over the years, what is the worst career advice you've ever been given?
The worst career advice I've ever been given is that civil engineering is a good job. And so before Dean's University starts sending me hate emails, and before I get a cease and desist from ASCE, let me qualify that. So I've worked lots of good jobs. I grew up in a rural environment. I have worked in construction. I have shoveled horse poop. I've done a variety of different things. I worked for a technician for the Forest Service doing mine reclamation for a long time. I've had good jobs. But when you talk about a career in civil engineering, it's not just a job. You don't get a clock out when you're done, right? It's not like you just put the pitchfork down and you're done for the day and don't think about it. I spend a lot of time thinking about my career and my profession outside of hours that are just working. And I really think that that's important because we have a responsibility to society. It's not a job, it is a profession. It's a craft that we do, and we have a duty to society. And when people just think that this is a job we do and we kind of clock in at 8 a.m. and go home and clock out at 5 when we're done. I mean, when I'm walking the dog at 5 a.m, I'm thinking about my projects. I'm thinking about client needs. I'm thinking about staff and how do I help them? And it is so much more rewarding than any other job that I've had because you are empowered to make the world a better place. And your sphere of influence, what you can do is tremendous. But it does take work and it does take adopting the attitude that I'm not just 40 hours a week, that my career development is my responsibility. And one of the biggest faults that I think we have as civil engineers is we understand what it takes to build great things. We know what it takes to build a mega project. It takes years and hours and long nights and coordination and patience and sweat and blood. But we don't ask ourselves, where do I want to be in 5 years? I'm building my career every day. Where do I want to be in 5 years? And how is what I'm doing today or this year getting me to where I want to be? And I think if we say this is a job, we miss out on that whole aspect that is so rewarding, is that you get to build your career and make it what you want. And, you know, you'll have nights where you'll go home and you'll think, man, I wish I would have had this conversation differently, or I should have approached this differently and said this a little different. But at the end of the day, over time, over 30 years, that extra effort is monumental. And what you're able to accomplish exceeds any other job I've ever had. I hope that makes sense, Brad.
It does. So for you, was this a realization that happened kind of in one moment, like you had a light bulb go on, or do you think it was something that developed over time?
You know, that's a great question. So as I was having this discussion with Ryan Cole about joining Gerhart Cole, he kept asking me that question. Ryan, where do you, I was confusing Ryan Cole and Ryan Ma, but Ryan, where do you want to be in 5 years? And he kept asking it, so we talked. And he wasn't saying, hey, you need to come join our firm. He wasn't selling me on that. He just kept saying, where do you want to be in 5 years? And then the next lunch, where do you want to be in 5 years? And after a while, I was like, yeah, where do I want to be in 5 years? And what am I doing to get there? And I think when you start asking that question, you start asking the next question and the next question, and that puts you closer. And so I wish I could credit that I had some intuition on that. Really, it was just good coaching.
Either way, you got there, and sometimes need a little bit of both, though. So one thing we're going to talk about next is the 2021 infrastructure bill, which is something I can't believe we haven't talked about in Director's Cut yet. You mentioned the Utah report card earlier on. I think in your story of how you were involved in this, it kind of starts with the report card, right? And what do you feel like your role was in the process there of getting this infrastructure bill last year to where it is?
So I wouldn't say that it was a massive contribution, but I do think it was something that anyone could do. And mm-hmm. It does make a difference. So I was involved in the first report card ever done for the state of Utah circa 2015. We had a good experience. We learned a lot. It was very positive. And then we kind of went ahead 5 years, 2020, and we put together the next report card. And initially my role was pretty minimal, but they needed support. And so I jumped into another role as the vice chair. And so I had a pretty significant role working with Craig Fryant as we were putting this together. So we put together the report card, and we worked with ASCE. They had some great resources, and we rolled it out to the media. It was very successful here locally. People really grabbed onto it, right? And so that was very helpful to where the discussion went next. So as they're rolling out and the White House is rolling out information and stats and figures, we're going through a few press releases, and lo and behold, there is text that we've written in our report card mm-hmm. that the White House is citing, right? Here's challenges we're having in the Intermountain West and water and other things, earthquake resiliency. And so that was the first interaction. So we're kind of like, well, maybe we better be engaging on this. So we started reaching out to representatives, and Senator Romney did not get a lot of support here locally for the infrastructure bill for a variety of reasons. And so we decided we were going to go meet with his office and have a discussion. So we went and visited with his office, and you know, you show up there and you've got your list of facts and figures, and we had our report card to go to. And so we show up there and we sit down, and they weren't interested in us. You know, as we engineers, we've got to be convinced by numbers. They weren't interested in numbers. What they cared about was that every day we're building infrastructure and that we had spent the time to dig into and understand challenges. And they just wanted us to help them understand those challenges and what they should be doing to improve them. They were sincere in their request. And so we just spent the time just talking. And it was eye-opening to me that we didn't need to have all these facts and figures, but what they did need to understand was that we were licensed professional engineers, members of a trade organization that had some background and was well thought of. And that was all it took to have the conversation. And as we were visiting through that, we explained, well, this is why the water part is so important to Utah. This is why it matters to your constituents. Here's why transportation, surface, and air is so important. And I'd like to think that, you know, having those discussions was helpful in informing them. I know there were a lot of different things in place, but it was amazing to me how easily we were able to get in front of them and have an audience and how much stock they put in what we had to say.
So I think that's another powerful message for everybody out there watching, is that your elected officials really do care what you think, and they will make time for you. If you've got something serious to go in and talk to them about, I'd encourage just about anybody to do the same thing that that Ryan did and go talk to your local elected officials, whether it's local, state level, federal. They all want to hear from you. You might be the only engineer they hear from all year. Think about that for a minute. So we have two questions left, and they're both kind of fun ones. And the first one we have to ask is, who is your all-time favorite teacher or professor, and why?
So I got a great education at Utah State, and I knew that I wanted to go into geotechnical engineering when I took Lauren Anderson's intro to soil mechanics class. And there's a lot of people that have the same experience. And also coincidentally, Lauren's responsible for me meeting my wife. I'll get to that. So Lauren would come in, he'd have a Diet Coke in his hand, he'd sit on the counter, and he would just go to the board and just start lecturing. And he was so passionate and excited about what he was doing. He took an interest in his students, he answered questions. And then I took Dr. Joe Caliendo's foundations class in the same thing. And I took Jim Bay's class on earthquakes. I thought, man, this is just cool stuff. And I really felt like I was with my people, right? I wasn't a guy who was interested in the nearest 10th of an inch. I was interested in feet and cool geologic stuff and ground shaking and other things. And so I really felt like I kind of found my people there. And the additions Utah State's made with John Rice and Brady Cox are really tremendous. It's going to be a great educational institution moving forward for a long term or a long time. More on how I met my wife. So I like to think about my soil mechanic class when I had time. And this was before cell phones. I'm still technically a millennial, but this was before cell phones. And so I would print off Dr. Anderson's sample exams, and I would take them with me, right? And at Utah State in the winter, it's a high mountain valley. It's so cold. There's not a whole lot to do but go to basketball games. And they got a spectrum there that's the center for basketball, and you have to get there a couple hours early. So they had an ESPN game, so I know it was going to be good. I showed up a couple hours early, and like any good engineering nerd, I took those sample exams, folded them up, and put them in my pocket, right? So I had 2 hours before the game, I could be studying, right? And so I pull them out, I'm studying, I'm kind of looking at a few things, getting ready for the exam, and here comes this cute girl walking down the steps to where I'm sitting, and she couldn't find a seat. She's with her friends, and she had a big A for Aggies painted on the side of her face. And I'm like, well, this girl's kind of cute. But I saved these seats for my friends. So I had this internal dilemma. What do I do? Do I bail my friends or go after the cute girl, right? Well, I went after the cute girl. So I asked my wife now to sit with me, and we ended up talking during the game. I found out she had these cool career goals and was really impressed with her. And so I didn't study as much for the exam, but I did get a first date out of her, and we went snowmobiling, got lost in a blizzard, and almost hit a moose. So it ended up being one of the best first dates ever, I think. But I think, you know, it just kind of shows to show how much I enjoyed the topic, and I still aced the exam. I got 100 on it right after. So even though I missed out on studying, it didn't really matter, and I got my wife. So I think that is very influential from Anderson's part. I think the other thing I just want to touch base on is When I started my career, I worked with a great mentor and coach, King Chien out of Seattle. And I really think the world of King and how he approached problems, his enthusiasm and passion, he was huge in my career. And one of the things that he said to me is the difference between a good engineer and a great engineer is one that reads. And I took that to mean that I should be finding opportunities to read and understand. So I set a goal. I would basically try and read an article a week or four a month. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it'd be as low as two. And when I would go out and do field work, I would take the papers with me. So if I'm going to go do drill shafts, I'd bring the FHWA manual. And when you have downtime, I would read about drill shafts. When I go out drilling, I'd take the site characterization manual. I'd read it about site characterization and take advantage of that downtime. Easy ways to get my articles in. But as time's progressed and I spend less time in the field, I find myself reading more of ASCE articles and other articles. And one of my, well, there's three favorites in my authors I like to read. First is Ben Flanius, because he's so practical, he focuses on the data, and he is passionate about what he does. The second is Kyle Rollins, because he goes after real problems, and he finds real practical solutions. And there's a bit of a rivalry between Utah State and BYU, so it's hard to say, but he's one of my favorites. And last but certainly not least is Kevin Franke, again, BYU, but he is a Utah State alumni. And I really feel like he's tackling important problems and asking hard questions and pushing the envelope. And so those are some of my favorites to read. All that being said, when I was at Utah State, I did, my research was a failure modes analysis of MSE walls, and it allowed me a chance to work with the DOT here. And I thought the geotech group was so awesome. And I was like, man, I want to spend my career working with these guys. You get to go build it and then you get to watch it operate for 75 years in traffic, and this is great. And you get to see what goes wrong and figure it out. And so I was working with Jim Bay at Utah State, and there was another university, Brigham Young University, BYU, and we had a chance to work together. And as we were doing that, the two PIs, Jim Bay and Travis Gerber, were working. And I really, as a young, dumb graduate student, but Travis had a lot of good comments, and he really pushed things along and asked hard questions. And so I finished my graduate school and I was looking for a job, and Travis was instrumental in me getting my first job. He put the word in. And then Travis left academia and went to practice as a consultant, and he got me my second job. And then he came and joined Gerhart Cole and was helpful in getting my third. And in each one of these different steps, Travis has been so patient in answering questions and listening to dumb things I might say and providing insight. His understanding of geotechnical and earthquake engineering is absolutely amazing. He's quite brilliant. But he has had, without a doubt, the biggest influence on my career of any professor that I've worked with. And I'm extremely grateful for that.
Well, that was fantastic. My biggest takeaway from that, obviously, you know, there's a lot in there, is you have no fear in taking documents with you places. I'm always terrified to even put a book in my suitcase when I travel because I'm scared that it's going to get destroyed. But you took sample exams to basketball games. You take technical papers or manuals out with you in the field. I would be so afraid that I was going to destroy them. But that's me. I have weird stuff about books and...
Geotechs don't have any fear of dirt. The dirtier the better, right? That's how proven it was with me.
So we got to have one final question here. And this is something, again, I think a lot of people out east take this for granted, that we've got, you know, pro sports teams and college sports teams absolutely everywhere here. And what is it? I know you're a big sports fan. What is it like to be a sports fan in Utah with only one pro team?
So I've got to correct you on one thing, but I won't argue with your point. We have the Utah Jazz and Real Salt Lake.
Oh,
and
that's,
I'm not
true.
A big soccer
MLS.
Fan.
Yeah.
That's right. But I am a big jazz fan. And I grew up in the era of Karl Malone and John Stockton, and my brothers and I would sit together and watch the basketball game going up against the Bulls, and it was an incredible time to be a jazz fan. And now is an incredible time with Donovan Mitchell and Gobert and Quinn Snyder as a coach. You know, it's a great time. What I will say is two things. So the first is that because we don't have a major football team here, college sports are intense. And they have holy wars here between BYU and University of Utah. And basically the informal policy at Utah State is you can lose every game that season, but as long as you beat BYU is a success. And so the in-state rivalries really make up for it. People have really embraced that. The second thing I'd say is, you know, it's kind of nice, too, because you've got flexibility, right? I'm a New York Yankees fan, and they're thousands of miles away because I'm not committed to the local team. And I watched the Core 4 in the 90s perform, and Mariano Rivera is absolutely amazing, right? More people have landed on the moon than scored on Mariano Rivera in the postseason. And so in a way, and I know there's a lot of Yankees headed out there, and I'm totally cool with that. But in a way, it's not a bug, it's a feature, right? I can kind of choose the team that I want to root for and go Yankees.
I like that. Yeah. And I don't know. I think my son's the big Yankee hater in our house. And that's just born out of him showing up at all these games in Baltimore. And, you know, especially when times are bad, outnumbering the Orioles fans and being very loud. That's the other thing they seem to do very well. So, Ryan, you made it through all the questions in Director's Cut, and you did it with flying colors. I think, you know, well, Sears a secret, everybody makes it through, but some do it better than others. Do you have any parting words for us today?
I do. So I guess the two thoughts I'd have for you, Brad, is one, I want to thank you for all you do. So I was with the local involvement committee when you initially stepped into your position as the director of the Geo-Institute. And I think we were in Orlando at the time, and here comes the new director, and everyone's like, oh, this should be interesting. This is going to be important. And here comes this ball of energy. And you get in front of the group and with the local involvement committee, and you were so enthusiastic and so positive. And there were some people, because engineers can find problems with anything, right? They were complaining about the food, and you were so positive. And here you go from basically directing, coordinating efforts with the International Space Station to dealing with a bunch of civil engineers, not only that, geotechnical engineers and geoprofessionals are a little bit grumpy. And I thought, you know, we were so lucky to have Brad here to bring that positivity and that energy to us. And I really appreciate what you do. And the second is the engineers are very good at finding problems and finding faults, but you know, cynics don't create, and we have to keep in mind how important it is, especially with the challenges we have right now, of being positive. The power of positivity is critical. And it's one thing to be able to say, here's the challenges and here's what I need to do to overcome it. It's another to sit back and be critical of everything. And so, Brad, I want to make sure that you understand how much I appreciate, as a member of the Geo-Institute, your positive energy and all you do to make us more positive and a better outreach to the community. So thank you for all you do.
Well, you're welcome, and thanks for the words, and I'm going to keep doing it as long as it's fun and as long as I can keep that smile on my face. So, again, we made it to the end. If you liked what you saw, viewers, and I think you probably did because you're here at the end, click subscribe, click get notifications. We'll let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel, whether it's Director's Cut, whether it's an award lecture, whether it's GeoStrata Extra, or any other of the many fine geotechnical programs that we are proud to offer. That was kind of a long sentence. Ryan, thanks again for doing this. I think we had a good time.
Really appreciate you, Brad. Hopefully you felt like it was
fun. Yeah, and I will see everybody with a brand new Director's Cut.